morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Microphone works.
Yes.
Good. Thank you for all being here today. Thank you
for welcoming me to come and speak to you and worship with you today. Before we get started with our worship service, are there any announcements anyone would like to make? Brian.
Hi, I'm Brian Allen. I'm the chair of the search committee, and I want to recognize my colleagues on the search committee who worked for the last year, Karen Underhill, Karen Tibbetts, Donna Stone, and Christy Wood. I can't see that far. Is that you?
Yes.
Good. So everyone is here, and we've found who we hope you'll endorse as our minister. Andres Berry's family is here also. So Andres is going to lead the, he's going to do the service and the sermon. Then we'll have time for a few questions. And then this is the United Church of Christ procedure. He goes into the Bailey Hall, and we vote by paper ballot, and it's just yes or no. So that will happen. Then we call him in, and then onward and upward. So I'll turn it over to Andres.
Thanks, Brian. Any other announcements? Anyone has it? Well, let's join together then in our call to worship. This is taken from Psalm 138. It's found in your bulletins. I will praise you, Lord, with all my heart. Before the gods, I will sing your praise.
I will bow down toward your holy temple and praise your name.
When I called, you answered me. You greatly emboldened me.
May all the kings of the earth praise you, Lord. May they sing from the ways of the Lord, for the glory of the Lord is great.
Though the Lord is exalted, he looks kindly on the lowly. Though lofty, he sees them from afar.
Though I walk in his trouble, you preserve my life.
You stretch out your hand against the anger of my foes. With your right hand, you save me.
Your love, Lord, endures forever. Do not abandon the works of your hands.
Let's join together in singing hymn number 131 in your red hymnals, We Gather Together. And you may stand if you wish. Thank you. Maybe seated. Now, are there any children here today? A few children. Would anyone like to come forward? You don't have to, but be nice to see you up here. Hello there. It's RJ. Yeah. Oh, I recognize you. Hey, everyone. Thanks for being here. Thanks for coming down. I have a question for you. Who here likes to play outside? Yeah. I like to play outside a lot too. Who here likes to see wild animals? Anybody like to see? Anybody see any bunnies jumping around in the grass?
I was like 10 feet away from that.
10 feet, you must have crept up, or did you surprise it?
I surprised
it. Nice. So you do. Well, I learned this trick a while ago, and it helped me see a lot of wildlife. It's really cool. And what it is, well, first of all, you have to kind of bear with me for a second. I want you to look straight ahead. You can look at me. Look straight ahead. And I want to hold your hands out. And I want you to wiggle your fingers. But don't look at your fingers. Look at me. Hold your hands out. Wiggle your fingers. Now, at the side of you. Can you see your finger? Can you see your own fingers wiggling while you're looking at me? Hold it by your head. Hold it up. Can you see your own fingers wiggling while you're looking at me? You all can try this, too. It doesn't have to be just us looking. But can you see your fingers? Can you see the periphery? Can you see? That's called your peripheral vision, right? You can see you have a wide peripheral vision. Now try it above and below. Can you see your fingers wiggling above you? And you're looking right at me, right? Yeah. No, don't look up at your fingers. You got to look straight at, look right at me. And you can see you have this wide peripheral vision, right? Did you notice that? You can see way out to the side. Now, one thing that we don't use our periphery. Sometimes we'll see something in the corner of our eye, but there's this thing called wide angle vision. And what you just did, seeing the periphery, you can relax your eyes and you can see this whole panorama. So right now, I'm looking straight ahead, but I can see everybody in the church. I can't see them in detail, but I can see them. And if somebody were to move or stand up, I could see them do it. You get to see this wide angle. And what's a really fun thing in nature, when you go outside, you can do it inside too, but what's really fun in nature, you go outside and you go into this wide angle vision. You open up your vision to see just everything around you. And all of a sudden, you'll see, oh, no, there's a bird moving there. Honestly, there's a bunny over there. You see things start to move and start to jump out, and you can focus in on them, and then you go back and you focus again. And I want you to try that today when you go outside. Try opening up your vision and just relax for a little while and see what you notice. You might see some things that you don't normally see when we're chasing bunnies, sneaking up on them, and things like that. So new things might pop up. Now, Jesus, when he talks to us in the Gospels, he's always saying, to open up our eyes and to see what's going on. Jesus heals blind people. And he's telling us, people that can see, he's always saying, open up your eyes a little more. See what's going on. Don't be so blind. Of course, we're not blind, but there's a lot more we can see. And this wide-angle vision, it helps us to see more things, especially out in nature. It's really fun. Thank you very much for joining. I don't think we have a Sunday school today, do we? No, okay. So we can go sit down with our parents again, and thank you for coming up. Oh, yeah, what do you want? There was a what at your house?
There was a bird in my house one time.
A bird in your house? Oh, your mom must have loved that. So I'm going to read from the Old Testament now, from the scripture of Isaiah. This is in our lectionary reading for this week. Isaiah 51, verses 1 through 6, from the Message translation. Listen to me, all you who are serious about right living and committed to seeking God. Ponder the rock from which you were cut, the quarry from which you were dug. Yes, ponder Abraham, your father, and Sarah, who bore you. Think of it. One solitary man, when I called him, but once I blessed him, he multiplied. Likewise, I, God, will comfort Zion, comfort all her mounds of ruins. I'll transform her dead ground into Eden, her moonscape into the garden of God, a place filled with exuberance and laughter, thankful voices and melodic songs. Pay attention, my people. Listen to me, nations. Revelation flows from me. My decisions light up the world. My deliverance arrives on the run, my salvation right on time. I'll bring justice to the people. Even faraway islands will look to me and take hope in my saving power. Look up at the skies, ponder the earth under your feet. The skies will fade out like smoke, the earth will wear out like work pants, and people will die off like flies, but my salvation will last forever. My setting things right will never be obsolete. It's the word of God. Now, as we enter into a time of prayer, before we go into our prayer, I'd like, if any of you have joys or concerns you'd like to offer up in prayer today for the group. Yes?
He forgets.
Okay. If you remember, call it out. Yes?
My sister Orpha.
Orpha. Okay. Yes, Phyllis.
Those who are homeless, and in particular, Sharon.
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 Yes, Brian.
Prayers for my husband, Stephen, who has Lyme disease and is just recovering from it.
Okay. Yes.
It's a joy to be here today.
Thank you. Yeah, it's a joy. Thank you.
The joys we should have is for parish priest, with full head of hair. There's not a lady. It's been a long time since I sat with a young man in front of me.
Thank you. Thank you. Sandy? Yeah, Karen.
It's good to see Kathy and Jack back with us. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, and anyone else? All right, as we enter into our time of prayer, let's take a moment to quiet ourselves, breathe, to calm our minds, give thanks to God, to hold up in our hearts any troubles, any joys, any concerns that we may have, offer them to God, and take this moment to pray, and we'll pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We come before you, we gather together in your name. And we know that you are here in our midst when we gather in your name, and we give you great thanks and praise. We thank you for this earth, its sustenance, for the sustaining power of your breath, the gift of life you've given to us, and the light in the world, and your Son, Jesus Christ. We come before you to offer our lives as living sacrifices to you, all our pain and our joy, our sorrows, our aches and pains, we offer to you. We thank you for your healing light. We ask you to watch over this congregation and the other congregations worshiping this morning. We ask you also for your blessings on Orpha. Watch over and heal Stephen as he recovers from Lyme disease, and all the other people suffering from illness and sickness. We ask you to watch over Sharon, bless and protect her, and surround her with your light. Watch over all others who are homeless at this time. We ask you to watch over the people of Maui, people who are homeless there as they struggle to understand what's going on. Help them to come together in community and to be supported for their needs. We thank you for the return of good friends, the congregation, and we thank you for this time together. We ask your blessings to watch over us and guide us in our daily walk by the light of Jesus Christ, who taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now, as we enter into a time of offering, we give what we may, as God has so generously given to us. Do we have ushers? Or time of offering? I'm new to this stuff. What do we do here? Gifts, and may they go out into the world to do your work to your glory. Amen. Let's join together in singing Take My Life and Let It Be, hymn number 399 in your hymnals.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Could I take a picture for the newsletter? Would anyone mind real quick? Y'all look so lovely today. Hi, Mary. Good to see you.
You get me in the periphery?
Yes. So today's reading is Romans 12 through 1 through 8. Romans 12, 1 through 8, the New International Version. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of the world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. For by the grace given me, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment, in accordance with the faith God has distributed to each of us. For just as each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function, so in Christ we, though many, form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. We have given different gifts according to the grace given to each of us. If your gift is prophecy, then prophesy in accordance with your faith. If it is serving, then serve. If it is teaching, then teach. If it is to encourage, then give encouragement. If it is to give generously, then give generously. If it is to lead, do it diligently. If it is to show mercy, do it cheerfully. The next reading this morning is Matthew 16, 13 through 20. Peter declares that Jesus is the Messiah. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do you say the Son of God, a man is? Who do you say the Son of Man is?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." "But what about you?" he asked. "Who do you say I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." Jesus replied, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Then he ordered his disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah.
The Word of God. So I had the pleasure of meeting some of you yesterday. We had a nice potluck here right next door. I know some of you have been to Southern California and you're familiar with the landscape there. That's where my family and I were living a couple of years ago. For those of you who haven't been to Southern California, it's a Mediterranean type of landscape. The mountains there are a lot different than the green and the Taconic mountains that you have here. The mountains there are covered with shrubs instead of trees. There's a rainy season in the wintertime, and so everything gets green for a couple months, and then it turns brown, and it just looks sort of this brown mountains. And because there's just shrubs and not trees, you can see the contours of the mountains. Everything is very visible, whereas here you can't see anything through the trees. It's a very different sense of space. Well, the chaparral, that unique sort of ecosystem, also occurs in the Holy Land, and it has just its own special features. About 20 years ago or so, I was working as a production assistant in California. I was working on TV commercials. So as I was driving around, I'd drive around in a big white box truck, and I'd go pick up equipment all over town. I'd get cameras and lights and all these other kind of things that you use to make commercials. And while I was doing that, I would notice at the end of one valley, there was a mountain that was kind of prominent at the end of the valley. And snaking up the side of that mountain was a pathway. And I always noticed it, and I always, it just stood out. So I always wondered, I wonder where that goes. I wonder what that's like. So this kind of occurred for a while. I'd keep noticing it. And so one day I had a day off. I decided I'm going to go find the trailhead for this pathway. I'm going to see where it leads. And so I went searching for it. I met some dead ends, and I finally found where the trail started. And I started walking up this trail. And what I immediately noticed is that what looked like a dead brown sort of landscape from a distance was actually incredibly intricate. It was beautiful. All these different shrubs, and they had different textures and contours. There were wildflowers that were very aromatic, sages and different types of sagebrush smelled sweet. There was wild honeybees all around. It, from the distance, what it looked dead and dry and brown, up close was incredibly intricate and beautiful, and had its whole own life to it. Well, that inspired me, so I went to the library and I started to get books out on the local flora and the fauna, and I started to read about the plants. I started to learn about the animals and different things like that. It really engaged me, that pathway, and I kept going up there, and I always get a workout too, because the mountains there are very steep. So it really wipes you out in no time just walking up there. But it led me into seeing this whole new world, and which got me a little bit into tracking. It got me into that wide-angle vision. I studied nature observation and different techniques for not just seeing but hearing things differently. And so that opened up a whole new world to me. And it was amazing. I also started to research the Chumash Indians and the way they lived. And so not only was I identifying plants, but then I could use them. I could use them to make tools, and I could use them to, you know, things that were edible and so on. I was starting to understand that. So it opened up a whole new world to me. And I thought that was really quite fascinating. But what was even more fascinating was that as I became engaged in the outside world and I was learning about that ecosystem, those lessons I was bringing with me back down into the valley when I would go back into work in my regular workaday world. And so I would go around Hollywood, and we'd be some days working on the beach. Some days we'd be in a big soundstage on a back lot of a movie studio. Some days we'd be in somebody's house doing these things. But I began to look at the movie sets kind of and the TV sets kind of like their own ecosystem. You had this design set, which was manufactured, and then you had the director and the camera operators and the actors and the people doing the lighting and all this groups of people, and they were all coming together. And I would stand back and I would observe and I would see how this whole thing worked. And then what was even cooler than that, I started to really think about, well, what are we really doing here? What are we making? What are we, you know, you. Somebody goes to a factory and they make a toaster and it toasts your bread, right? Or you go collect sap from the trees and you boil it down and you make syrup, right? What are we making in Hollywood? I started to think about that. And I said, well, we're really just capturing light and sound. You know, back when I started, we were using film. So we had these big cans of film, and I'd have to take them at the end of the day to get developed at a different processing places. Nowadays, it's just a little hard drive that you take. It's all just digital. But back then, there was something to take. But still, it wasn't the film, really, that was what we were producing. It was images, lights. And then so it got me thinking some more. And I said, well, we're not really producing commercials. What we're really producing, you know, these commercials, these images that we're doing are designed to conjure up desires in people. Like, they have a job to do. The tool of the commercial is to make you want things. And so you're not really making a commercial. What you're doing is you're arranging some lights to invoke some desires in people. So it got me thinking, we're not really producing commercials, we're producing desires in people. And that got me really thinking. I said, well, that's really interesting. That's not quite what I thought I was doing when I was driving around in my truck initially. So you know, what are these things? What are these tools, these images, the function? President Calvin Coolidge, I read this, I don't know if he actually said it or not, but they say that he said, advertising ministers to the spiritual side of trade. Well, that's an interesting idea. You didn't think of trade having a spiritual side to it. But anyway, we're working with desires and we're working with this. So if it's not spiritual, it's certainly metaphysical in some kind of way. We're working with the intangibles of heart and mind. Anyhow, that's a little background on the commercial stuff. But the nature observation really helped me to discern that a little bit in what I was doing on the commercials. And what the wide-angle vision had done for me, start to see things differently, I noticed that the commercials are kind of on the opposite end of that spectrum. What the commercials do for us is they produce something called tunnel vision, which is the exact opposite of wide-angle vision. We zero in on things. That's sort of the nature of a lot of media. Tunnel vision tends to squash introspection. It squashes a broader perspective. It happens when we focus so intently on one thing that we forget the big picture. We get lost in minutia. That was partly also what was happening to me when I was running around town in my truck. I was really in the valley floor, and I was involved in work all the time. And that's maybe a little bit why that pathway kept calling to me. It wanted to get me up and off the valley floor, get me out of that situation. That those of us who get addicted to work, that's a little bit, you know, that feeling. You get tunneled in, and I want to do something with my wife or my kids or my, you know, but I got this stuff to do, and you tunnel in. Anyhow, that was sort of my experience, and when I was reflecting on the scripture reading from today from Paul, it really made me think about not so much the whole scripture, which is there's so much in Paul's letters that we'd be here for a long time if I tried to go over the whole scripture. So I want to focus on the one sentence that really stood out to me. Paul writes, "Do not conform to the patterns of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind." It's such a powerful and beautiful statement. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. The statement has two parts. The first part of that sentence identifies a problem, and the second part identifies or offers a solution to that problem. When Paul cautions the Roman church not to conform to the patterns of this world, the Greek word he uses for world is cosmos. And that Greek word is used, it can have a couple of different meanings. It can mean all of creation. So when we read God so loved the world, he's talking about creation. Or it can mean the systems of power and culture. So for instance, when Jesus gets tempted and the devil takes him out and takes him to a high place and shows him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world, that's also the cosmos, kingdoms of the world. And that's what Paul is referring to in this statement. Do not conform yourself to the patterns of the world. The devil could offer the kingdoms of the world because the devil had authority over them. It is this meaning that Paul uses, and it carries a sense of the world's corrupted power systems, the kingdoms of the world. Theologian Walter Wink calls it the domination system. In Roman times, the domination system was apparent to all the members of society. The Roman Empire governed by force, and it governed by intimidation of force. And the system was ruthless against its enemies, both without and within. The cross at that time was a symbol of terror. Jesus and John the Baptist had both been killed because they were threats to the power systems. And Paul, by preaching and writing about Jesus at this time, was also a threat. And he was in danger of being killed for these letters, even. Now, there's a lot we could discuss about the domination systems in the world today. I think we're all quite aware of systems of power. It's something that we can discuss more openly now in these days. We have some glaring representations. We have military-industrial complex that runs roughshod all over the world. We have corporations that have poisoned the land and the water and the air. We have a pharmaceutical industry that's thriving while people keep getting sicker. We have communities that have been decimated with drug addictions, poverty, and there's a multi-billion dollar industrial prison complex. I could go on with all these things, but I'm sure you get the idea. The domination system is alive and thriving in our midst. And these are the hallmarks of the powers that be. They're symptoms of a system that is failing to uphold the values of fairness and justice and health for the majority of people, while they uphold the profits and the power of very few. It is a kingdom of the world, and the kingdom of the world is in opposition to God's kingdom. So Jesus came, they expected the Messiah to be a king in the classical sense, come riding in on a sword with a horse, but Jesus' kingdom, God's kingdom, is opposed to the kingdoms of the world. It doesn't work like that. It doesn't work on violence, retribution. One of the big challenges I find for us today is to be able to see the system for what it is without feeling overwhelmed by that system. That's something the Romans had to deal with as well, the Romans that Paul was writing to. They were in the heart of the empire, just like you can imagine people living in Washington, D.C. or something. They were in the midst of it. How do you live inside the power systems of the world without being dominated by the power systems of the world? We've all been born into this, and that makes it very hard to see the conditions that we're born into. What's more, the domination system itself, it actively perpetuates this type of tunnel vision. We focus on certain things that are big problems and so on, and we forget the big picture. We forget to look for God in the world while all these things are going on. In Jesus' time, the Pharisees were the religious authority, and they were caught up in the rules themselves. They were caught up in the rules of hand washing. You're not supposed to work on the Sabbath. They had forgotten what the original intent of the rules was, which was to bring all of us closer to God. It's easy to get caught up in the rules or get caught up in the system and focus on something and forget the big picture. We're caught up in distractions of all kinds. We get caught up in the news, we get caught up in politics, which very often leads us to becoming more frustrated with our neighbors and getting angry and getting into a state of despair. We all know about the tunnel vision that our devices can produce. Has anybody here ever walked into a wall while looking at their phone? I have too. I'm a little embarrassed about it, but it happens, right? We get so focused in on things. So anyway, yesterday you were very gracious and you invited my family and I to a potluck here. And it was really nice to experience your hospitality and your generosity. And for those of you who weren't here yesterday, after we ate, there was an opportunity to ask some questions. And I know Brian said, I don't want to put you on the spot, but I'm going to put you on the spot anyway. So thank you, Brian. What happened, though, there was a couple questions that really gave me pause and then made me think later on. And so I'll share those with you. The first question asked me what I thought the number one problem was facing America today. I'm paraphrasing, so forgive me for if I don't. But what the number one problem was in America today. And I responded to that as best I could. And then the next question that was asked was, what is my vision for the church? And this is also a great question. They're powerful questions. They're challenging questions. And I think that we need to take challenging questions and deal with them. They're not always easy, but that doesn't mean it's not worthwhile to consider them and to try and respond. So I reflected on those questions, and I thought, well, I thought that maybe the answer to the first question was found in the second question. What's the problem, not just in America, but what's the problem in the world? We could take America for an example, and perhaps the biggest problem in America is a lack of vision. The lack of seeing what's going on, seeing our fellow citizens, our fellow people as neighbors, as children of God. Vision to see the world as a sacred creation, which is constantly being desecrated in numbers of ways. The vision to see where we're going, Do we have a collective vision? Are we going to send people to space, or are we going to, what's our vision? Where are we going? If I could identify one problem, and I know there are many, that might be one. Proverbs 29:18 states, where there is no vision, the people perish. If you don't know where you're going, if you can't see clearly and chart a course, well, you're walking in the dark. Jesus talked about the Pharisees, blind leading the blind, you fall into a pit. We need our visions. We need to be able to see clearly. I think one of the biggest symptoms of the cosmos, the world in this day and age, is that it works to actively produce tunnel vision, myopic, narrow-minded viewpoint. While the powers that be, they maintain a posture of intimidation against the people, much of their work is done more covertly through manipulation. Our screens draw us inward and away from interacting with others. Many of the messages in advertising, they draw our attention towards material things. Many of our news programs divide us into political tribes rather than helping us to understand the issues. In many ways, we're people that lack vision, not just a vision about what is going on around us, but a vision about where we're going. And this is where the second part of Paul's statement comes in. That's why I like, he identifies, don't conform yourself to the patterns of this world. He says, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. A renewing of the mind involves opening up our vision, discarding the old and narrow-minded ways of thinking, leaving behind tired old ways of seeing the world. Tunnel vision is kind of like looking through binoculars backwards. You ever tried that? You put the binoculars backwards and you just see these little points of light and everything around it is dark and you can't see anything outside the binoculars. That's kind of like what tunnel vision is. Renewing the mind opens us up to new possibilities and new horizons and new beginnings. Now, from the outset of their ministries, both John the Baptist and Jesus said, repent, repent. John said, repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near. Jesus says, I have not come to call the righteous, but the sinners to repentance. And we tend to think of repentance as regret, sort of rearward looking. Oh, I'm sorry I did that. That's not what the Greek word for repentance is. The Greek word is metanoia. The Greek word for repentance means, of metanoia means a change of mind, a fundamental change of mind, a change of course even. So what John the Baptist and Jesus are saying are, change your mind because the kingdom of heaven is here. I came to call all of you sinners. Kingdom of heaven is near. Change your mind. We are called to change our mind from the conforming patterns of the domination system with its violence and retribution, the me-first attitudes and self-serving interests. We are called to see the world in a new way. We are called to a change of mind that will transform us into new people, give us new life. We are called to metanoia. So as we leave here today, it's worthwhile to think about ways in which we have conformed to the world's patterns. I can only speak personally, but I think that it's a common thing to be conformed to the world in which you're born, living in the cosmos as we are. But more importantly, think about how you may be transformed by a change of mind. Like Paul in that one sentence, don't get hung up even on the conforming to the patterns of the world. Focus on how you may be transformed by a renewing of your mind, how you may see things in a new way. Paul suggests, and this is so beautiful about the passage, he suggests that we make ourselves living sacrifices to God. Now, sacrifice is an old term, but what Paul means is that we offer our lives to God no matter what we're doing, whether we're at work or at school, whether we're at home with our families or walking in the mountains alone. Paul writes, take your everyday, ordinary life, your sleeping, eating, going to work, and walking around life, and place it before God as an offering. The more we bring all aspects of our lives into relationship with God, the more our lives will be transformed. It's kind of, I think my old concept was that oh, I will be transformed and then I'll go to God. He says, no, it's actually the other way around. Offer your life to God, then you'll be transformed. It's a choice. It was many years ago when I was driving around in a hot, dry, smoggy floor of the valley, and that pathway emblazoned on the side of the mountain beckoned me. And I can still picture it, and sort of seared in my mind, that path going up the mountain. I started climbing that quite regularly, and in a way, I haven't stopped. I'm still receiving lessons from that path. In the same way, I think the gospel light of Jesus calls to all of us. It's like that pathway. It's a light. We are meant to follow him, climbing ever higher as we are transformed on our journeys. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Jesus calls us to use our vision. Don't keep your eyes closed. Don't stay narrow. The light of the world calls us to follow him through the darkness of the world. No matter what the cosmos is offering us, no matter how dark things are, we have the light of the world. Keep focused on that. Keep focused on it here and now, out there and always. Let's pray together. Dear Lord, please bless us with vision. Renew our minds that we may be transformed into the people that you have called us to be. Amen. Let's join together in singing hymn number 400, Come Thou Font of Every Blessing. Bless you and keep you. May God make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. Let's go out in joy with the light of Christ in our lives. Open our eyes to new sights and new visions. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.